trial. We spent some time last week looking at his crucifixion, wanting to really just get us to the place where we were looking at that week of passion and the week of his suffering. How it quickly changed from hosannas to crucify. Those same voices that cried out, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. With palm branches waving, soon threw the palm branches down, with clenched fists were screaming, crucify him. And so we're coming to the place where we look at the resurrection. But let's remind ourselves that Jesus died on that place. I said that Calvary is that place where the cliffs are behind, on that hill where he dies between two thieves, so that it can be fulfilled what has been prophesied by Isaiah, that he was numbered with the transgressors. So here he is, he's dying with criminals. And we often think about the cross, and we think about that sign being above his head that said, Jesus, King of Jews. And what that really was for everyone that was hung on the cross, the curse of dying on the cross, what they were being accused of was written above them. And his was that he was King of the Jews. It was written in Aramaic, it was written in Latin, it was written in Greek. And it's very unique that Jesus' sign, for most folks it would be a disgrace, but there was no disgrace in what his sign says, because he was King of the Jews. He was King of the world. He was Lord of lords and King of kings. And as he cries, it is finished, he wasn't talking about that he was going to die and that his life was soon over, but the task that the Father had sent him to do was finished. Interesting, in that crucifixion, I'm just sharing a few things that I think are points of interest before we get to the resurrection. We find that as he says, it is finished, he dies. Now, in Exodus 12, verse number 46, the Word of God declares that the Passover lamb was to have no broken bones. And Jesus was a fulfillment of the Passover lamb. That was all shadow or type of what would be the Savior. And Jesus, he dies before they have a chance to even break his legs. So as they come by, the spear is put into his side. Water and blood flows out, as was already prophesied. They did not break his legs because he is dead. The reason why they would break legs, some of you may know this, but the reason for that, it would hasten death. They were looking for, because of it being the time that it was, and needing dead bodies to be placed because of their custom and their culture, they were wanting to hasten death. Jesus has died. The reason why they would break legs is because really what would happen to a person who is crucified, they would die of asphyxiation, which means they would be struggling to breathe. And so as they're wanting to get release and being able to breathe, they would take, and even though their feet were pierced, even though it was painful, they would push themselves up so that it would give their lungs a little bit more freedom so that they could breathe. And so if someone had not died, Brother Justin, they would break the legs, because it would bring that of asphyxiation quicker and sooner. And so there they are gasping for breath, but Jesus had no fracture in his legs. And there was no fracture because it was prophetically spoken, and he was that type of a Passover lamb. He was the Lamb of God. He was the spotless. He was a lamb that was watched. He was a lamb that was found spotless and without blemish. We find that Jesus conquers death. Jesus controlled death. Death did not control him. And he died in humanity's place. Then he rose from the dead, conquering the bondage of death for us. I love that. So let's look at John chapter number 20. I'm going to be bouncing back to chapter number 19, but not till I get down to verse number 5. So just keep your Bibles open. I'm just going to kind of share a few things. Someone just read verse number 1.
Verse 20?
Yes, chapter 20, please.
The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark into the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre.
So, a little bit of information about this verse. I know it's just starting out and getting things rolling, so to speak, of what's happening at the resurrection. But here comes Mary Magdalene. Now, we know from the other Gospels that there are others. So John is not giving us a video of everything that's happening. He's giving us a snapshot of Mary Magdalene, if that makes sense. So he's focusing in on her, and he's sharing. We know that there are others, but the snapshot is given to us of Mary Magdalene, and she comes to the sepulchre. It's early morning. And it's probably about 5 o'clock in the morning, most folks would seem to think. And the stone was taken away from the sepulcher. I said on Sunday, weighing several hundred pounds, maybe there was some dialogue as they come, how they would remove the stone because they want to get in and put these spices on Jesus' body as part of the embalming practice that they were using in those days. But when she comes early in the morning and she's with the other woman, she sees the stone that's taken away, and she did not expect to see the stone moved. She did not expect to see the resurrection. She was totally taken off guard. Oftentimes, we are taken off guard by the promises of God because in our humanity, we can forget. And so she's forgotten. And so go ahead and read verse number 2, Brother Justin.
Then she runneth and cometh to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved, and saith unto them, They have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre, and we know not where they have laid him.
All right. So here it is that she comes running. She sees that stone is moved. She beholds his body is not there. It's obvious. She sees it in the breaking of day. The stone is moved. The body is not there. She is very concerned. She goes running to Peter, to John. John referencing himself as the one that Jesus loves. And they said, they have taken my Lord out of the sepulchre, and I know not where they have taken him. Now, none of these believed in the resurrection, and we'll see more evidence as we go on. They just were not anticipating. They had forgotten. Jesus told them that they would be in mourning while the world would be rejoicing. That's exactly their mourning. And sometimes you're disillusioned. And when you lose someone close to you, sometimes you forget to eat. Sometimes you forget to sleep. Sometimes you forget that, you know, I mean, you're just totally lost. Your world is in a shuffle. You know, we often see our loved one maybe even dying, and they have medical intervention on them where the pain is not excruciating. Think of this: watch Jesus die this terrible death, and they loved him. It's not what they anticipated. They loved fellowship with him. They trusted him as God Almighty. They're just blown away that God would die like this. And if they've seen him die, they've wrapped his body, they've laid him in the tomb, they've seen all this, they're just so overwhelmed. Imagine the emotion. Maybe she thought that Nicodemus and Joseph had taken his body and put it somewhere else. Maybe that was a thought in her mind. The Bible says Peter went forth and that other disciple and came to the sepulcher. So they ran both together, and the other disciple, which is John, did outrun Peter and came first to the sepulcher. John, man, he wants to know what's happening. He says, I got there before Peter did. We're both making our way to the sepulcher. I ran and got there. And John stoops down. He doesn't go in, but he stoops down. And stooping, looking in, he saw the linen clothes lying. Yet went he not in. He goes here by the Justin. He sees it. He doesn't go in the linen clothes. What is this? Let's jump back so that we understand these linen clothes a little bit to the last chapter. And someone read verse number 39 down to verse number 42, and we'll talk about that for a few minutes. Chapter 19, verse 39 through 42. All right, so there's lots of information and good stuff. Like, why does John tell us some of this stuff? I'm going to tell you why he tells us some of this stuff. Because it's important so that we can have validation to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Bible says that Nicodemus, and I love this, because remember Nicodemus, when he came to Jesus by night, he walked away, and we don't see this conversion in his life that we'd like to see. But we find the cross makes a difference. Does that mean something tonight? The cross makes a difference. And so he and Joseph, they get the body of Jesus and with a mixture of myrrh and aloes. The Bible says weighing a weight of 100 pounds. They took it to bury Jesus. And let me say this. Mostly Daniel, it was just rich people, wealthy people who had this type of burial. They had the money. They weren't anticipating Jesus resurrected. They spent all this money and all this time, and so they just want to give him a decent burial. They want to do what is right. So they invest a lot of money. Hey, if it's 3 days later, you're going to spend all that money? He's going to resurrect? They were not expecting the resurrection. And the Bible says that they wrapped him in linen cloths and with spices as the manner of the Jews to bury. He looked like a mummy. He was wrapped up in all these linen cloths. And then his face was so grossly distorted because of just the anguish of the cruelness that was poured out upon him. His face was swollen beyond recognition. And so this cloth was laid over his face. And the Bible says, and John's the only one to mention this, that there at Calvary there was a garden. And in the garden was a tomb, a new tomb, where never a man had been laid. John's the only one to give us this information. He must know that some years later, there's some validation and needing to know this. So it was right there. And no one else has ever been buried there. So there's no mix-up. Wasn't like they could, I wonder whose body this is. No one's ever been buried there. There's only one man, Jesus. So you can't say that there was a mix-up. There was only one man, no one else was ever buried there before, and they laid him there because of the Jews' preparation. Speaking of Passover, which was going to come at sundown. So they needed to get him and get him there and get him buried. The Bible says John comes and he sees the linen clothes. And he sees the face napkin away from that. The Bible says in verse number 6, then came Simon Peter following John. I put John in there. And went into the sepulcher and saw the linen cloth lie. Now there's something neat that we need to hear about this word lie, because we're going to think about it being this. If I would say, where's my coat? You might say, it's laying up there on that basketball shelf. It's not really what the word lie means here. The lie in the original context means that it was neatly folded. What does that mean? Well, it means this. That if someone was trying to steal the body of Jesus, why in the world would they unravel all that linen cloth? And why would they take time to take his face napkin off and fold it up neatly and place it? So the actions speak that if someone was there in haste, they would never have done all these things that was done. And so John is telling us that. But this was deliberately done because it is proof of the resurrection. Jesus said, I don't need these grave clothes anymore. This napkin is folded up. And he laid it to the side. It shows also that Jesus wasn't a spirit, but in bodily form, he resurrected. Praise God. He's not a spirit. He wasn't a spirit. It was in his body that he resurrected. Then went in the other disciple, which is John, into the sepulcher, and he saw and he believed. Now, he's not believing in the resurrection, because we'll see later, that's not, he believed what Mary Magdalene said. Someone has taken the body of Jesus. It's gone. Where's the body of Jesus? The Bible says, for as yet they knew not the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Referring to Psalms chapter number 16. Then his disciples went away unto their own home. So they go to their own place. They're there. We'll understand a little bit more about that later if we get there tonight. The Bible says, but Mary. And this is like emotionally stirring for me as I think about Mary. I mean, it's amazing. But Mary stood without at the sepulcher, weeping. Peter and John, they're gone. She's told them, Brother Dustin comes back. Look, Craig, what have they done with my Lord? The Bible says she wept, she stooped, and she looked into the sepulcher. John's the only one that really gives us this information that Mary Magdalene came back. And so, though years has passed, John finds once again through the Spirit of God that this is some validation that is needing to be given to the resurrection story. The Bible says, and saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus has been laid. If there was ever a picture of the mercy seat, here's a picture of the mercy seat. An angel here, an angel there. The wings are outstretched in between is where the body of Jesus lay. It is where the blood has been sprinkled. It is where mercy is so much given. I mean, it is amazing to think about this. The Bible says, and they said unto her, woman, why do you weep? She's not even like astonished at these angels. Daniel, what would you do if you saw angels? I guarantee you tonight, if two angels come up here and stood at the side of me, I guarantee you every one of you would be like, your eyes would be gazing. You might be shaking. You might be saying, oh, you know, I don't know how you would respond. But you would be excited. You'd be looking. You'd be wanting. She wasn't even concerned. The angels didn't startle her. It was simply that she wanted to know where Jesus was. You talk about just an awesomeness of wanting to know where her Savior was. Woman, why do you weep? See, Mary Magdalene, what we do know about her is that Jesus cast demons out of her. Her life was changed because of this man. She wanted to find him. Nothing was going to distract her from finding the Lord. You know, really that should be when God has changed our life so immensely. There should be nothing that distracts us from finding God in the middle of our life. Whether it's our job, whether it's our marriage, whether it's our children, whether it's seeking Him for our future. Whatever it is, there should be nothing that should distract us from finding Jesus. She said unto them, because they have taken my Lord away, and I know not where they had laid him. I just want to know where his body is. I want to be where he is. Just tell them. The angels already knew that there was no cause to weep. So they asked her. And when she had thus said, she turned herself back. Or better spoken, she was caused to be turned around. Listen, a wounded, seeking heart will not be distracted from the presence of God. Here is the The Bible says that when she turned herself back, she saw Jesus standing and knew not that it was Jesus. Now, there's a couple of things that we need to look at here. Why didn't she know that it was Jesus? Why do you think she didn't know it was Jesus? He probably looked different in his glorified body. I'll agree with that 100%. I think there's something else. What do you think is maybe even greater than not recognizing Jesus in his glorified body? Not that that's very valid, but minimizing that all. You're almost there. Because she wasn't expecting him to do that. It's unbelief. I can't be him. I can't be him. Unbelief. She wasn't believing he was going to be resurrected. None of them were. The Bible says that. So he looks different, but in unbelief, she's not expecting to see him and know him. And the Bible says that Jesus said unto her, notice this word right here, and I'll deal with it a little bit later. Woman. Woman. Woman, why do you weep? He's asking the same question that the angels ask. Because he's asking it the same reason that angels are asking it. Because by virtue of the resurrection, we have no cause to weep. By virtue of the resurrection, we have no cause to weep. And then he said to her, whom do you seek? She's supposing him to be a gardener. Probably Joseph of Arimathea. This is his garden. He has money. She's just supposing that this is someone Joseph has hired to work here in the garden. And she said unto him, sir, if you have borne him hence, tell me where you have laid him. Listen, tell me where that sacred body is. I have brought spices. Now remember, this could, this woman, she spent maybe all the money that she has in buying spices and things for the embalming and the preparation. She spent everything. Just tell me where his body is. I've spent all to come and pay tribute to it. Listen, maybe she was afraid that they took him to the dump and threw him in the dump. I want him to have a proper burial. I want him to be taken care of. Give him to me and I'll take care of him. She said, I will take him away. Then Jesus says unto her, Mary. Now I told you I wanted to deal with that woman and the word Mary. First he speaks in Sister Trinity, he speaks to all humanity. And their suffering, he speaks to everyone. But there's not one that's not spoken to in their humanity because God wants to touch suffering. People. And then Sister Beth, he says, Mary. On the individual level, he wants to speak and encourage her. What a mighty God. For all of humanity, but yet individually. And so, the Bible says, she turned herself. She recognized his voice. How powerful. Even though she's in doubt and in disbelief, even though his body, Brother Justin, as you said, looks different, his voice is the same, and she recognizes it. And she says unto him, Rabboni, which is the same master. When he speaks to her, he deals with four uncertainties, four great enemies of the human heart. Sorrow, fear, doubt, and care. Sorrow, fear, doubt, and care. He speaks to her, Brother Eli.
to the heart that every one of us have. Every one of us can deal with doubt. Every one of us can deal with fear. Every one of us can deal with sorrow. Every one of us deals with care. And he spoke to her in such a way that he let her know that I'm concerned about you. The Bible says, and Jesus said unto her, touch me not. Was it not that she couldn't reach out and touch him? That wasn't the essence of what most scholars think that Jesus was saying. Because he told Thomas to touch him. The idea is, Mary Magdalene, you can't hold on to me. He said, for I am not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Everybody, I'm not here to say, you're not always going to have me. But I'm going to ascend to my Father, to your Father, to God, to your God. What was he saying? He was saying this, Brother Eli. Because now is redemption. Because of what I've done and the work between the Father and I'm mediating between you and the Father, the work of redemption is done. Thank God for the work of redemption. And the Bible says that Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that she had spoken he had spoken these things unto her. The Bible says, then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, Sunday once again, when the doors were shut and the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews. Now why would they be fearful? Why would they be fearful of the Jews? Why do you think? You're right, brother. They just slayed Jesus. They hated him. Do they want to annihilate his followers now? So they're in their home and they're fearful. The Bible says that Jesus came and stood in the midst. Jesus came and stood in the midst. The doors were closed. We don't have a lot of information, but he's there. All of a sudden he's there, Brother Doug. They are fearful. And you know what he said unto them? He said unto them, peace be unto you. It is something that was commonly spoken in their day, in their culture, in their custom. But Brother Doug, it was speaking volumes because there they were, locked in their house, Brother Craig. They were fearful. But he comes in and he says, peace. You don't need to be fearful. Listen, sometimes I believe that what we need to do in our life, when anxieties are high and there's fear of things, fear of whatever, amen, we need to shut the doors until Jesus shows up and we hear him speak and say, peace be unto you. He can change the situation. It speaks volumes. And when he had so said, he showed them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. What a revelation of peace. As my Father has sent me, even so send I you. He said, God has sent me, God the Father has sent me to preach the gospel of salvation. He sent me to tell you that you need to repent, that you need to know me as your Savior. He's preaching salvation. And then I love this next part. This is powerful. And when he had said this, he did what? He breathed on them. Was there ever another time in the Word of God we hear about God breathing? Way back in the beginning. God breathed the breath of life into man, didn't he? And so, just as he had performed on Adam, he breathes the breath of life. He now breathes the breath of life through the Spirit of God on his sons and his daughters. And he said unto them, receive you the Holy Ghost. Now this isn't that they received the Holy Ghost with evidence of speaking in other tongues, but because of the work that was done for salvation, now they have the privilege of receiving the Holy Ghost with evidence of speaking in other tongues.